painkillers are so important, but are they safe? More specifically, is Metacam safe for cats? We used to think that cats weren't too affected by pain. Well, of course they are. And now our cats are living longer, many are suffering from the effects of chronic pain due to arthritis, as well as following surgery or suffering injuries. Hi, I'm Dr. Alex Avery from ourpetshealth.com, helping you and your cat to live healthier, happier lives. Now, this drug is one of the most commonly used medication in cats. Meloxicam is the active ingredient, with Metacam being the most common trade name product used. It is a member of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug group, which has been discussed separately in a video, All You Ever Wanted to Know About Non-Steroidals. Today though, I want to talk about safety in cats specifically. So Metacam's use in cats is highly controversial in some parts of the world, notably the US. Despite this, it is completely accepted by the majority of vets in other parts, notably Europe and Australasia. This has led to different licensing of the product. In other words, the same drug has different dosing regimes depending on where it is being used. In Europe and Australasia, meloxicam can be used as a one-off injection, it can be given orally for several days after a lower dose injection, or it can be used for the long-term management of pain, such as that caused by arthritis. In the US, however, it can only be used as a single injection to comply with its licensing. There is also a so-called black box warning from the FDA, which states that repeated use of meloxicam in cats has been associated with acute renal failure and death. Do not administer additional injectable or oral meloxicam to cats. Now that's pretty scary stuff, but surely both approaches and both opinions can't be right. Well, in a way they can, but that doesn't mean that both are in the cat's best interest. No one will deny that there are risks with giving any non-steroidal, and cats do appear to be more sensitive to these drugs. It's been shown clearly that giving the highest licensed dose for just 3 days can cause mild changes in the intestines and kidney, with 9 days of this treatment dose causing intestinal ulceration and peritonitis. In very rare instances, a single dose may cause acute kidney failure, but again, this really is very, very rare. The fact of the matter is though, that for long-term treatment, the licensed dose is 6 times less than this single treatment dose. The additional benefit of meloxicam being available as a liquid is that it gives us the ability to gradually reduce the dose given to the lowest effective dose. But how do we know that this is safe? Well, there have been several studies looking at this, with a couple of studies in Australia that looked at safety. In these, patient histories of cats over 7 years of age were collected, and those cats taking Metacam for arthritis were compared with those not taking Metacam. When cats were free of renal disease before starting treatment, there was no difference in kidney function as they aged, regardless of whether they were receiving Metacam or not. When the cats already had kidney damage before starting Metacam, now that was actually less deterioration in kidney function in those cats taking Metacam compared to similar cats not taking the drug. This means that rather than be dangerous, long-term meloxicam may actually help to delay the worsening of disease in cats with otherwise stable chronic kidney failure. Now, as with most studies, there are some points worth noting. This study was funded by the manufacturers of Metacam, so there may very well be some bias here. Also, the dose of Metacam given was very low, less than half the licensed dose for long-term use, or 12 times less than the licensed single-use dose. Now, this doesn't mean that it wasn't working, just that the dose may well be much lower than that given to cats who have experienced side effects. Finally, a study looking back at records like this is less valuable and less powerful than ones where animals are looked at and followed during treatment. Now, despite all these facts, the study clearly shows that the Australasian and the European approach is likely to be perfectly sensible and unlikely to be as reckless as suggested by the US black box warning. I really hope that there will soon be more studies that look into this to either back up or to refute these findings. Now, the flip side is that non-steroidals offer our cats one of the best chances of a pain-free life, be that during the recovery from surgery, getting over a ligament or muscular injury, or living with arthritis long-term. Yes, there are alternative painkillers, but none of them are proven to work as well in cats, especially long-term, and in most instances, they themselves are actually not licensed for this use either. Pain has many detrimental effects. It has a massive impact on the cat's quality of life and it should not be ignored. Now, of course, we don't want to use any drugs irresponsibly, and there are a number of actions we can take to reduce the risk of any side effects. The first of these is to run some blood tests in older patients or any patient that is likely to be taking the drug on a long-term basis. A pre-treatment blood sample should be taken with following up monitoring bloods run as advised by your vet. This will help pick up those individuals where there are concerns regarding liver or kidney function. If this is the case, then it may be that an alternative treatment plan is made or that your cat is monitored more closely to be sure they don't deteriorate. Now, number two is to stop if vomiting or diarrhea develops. Any cat that experiences vomiting or diarrhea should not continue to take the drug or risk the development of stomach ulcers. A few days off treatment will most likely result in recovery, although your vet may want to give them some treatment to aid in this recovery. It may be that your cat will be fine if they start the drug again. After all, vomiting and diarrhea is a fairly common problem in otherwise healthy cats who are not on any treatment. For those seriously affected though, or known to have very sensitive stomachs or with other concerns, it may be that alternative treatments are then explored. So next up is to stop if your pet appears depressed, if they become unwell, if they stop eating or drinking. If your cat is unwell for any other reason, if they stop eating or drinking, then do not continue to give a non-steroidal. The reason for this is that if a cat becomes dehydrated, then their organs may be under strain. An anti-inflammatory is then more likely to cause damage, especially to their kidneys. Now, running quickly through the rest of our actions is to not give a higher dose than your vet has prescribed. At number five, do not give any non-steroidals at the same time as steroids or any other non-steroidal. Next, we have the fact that you should not use human painkillers unless specifically advised to by your vet, and never, ever give your cat paracetamol. And then at seven, you should always contact your vet promptly if you have any concerns. Number eight is to use other management and treatment strategies for arthritis and other chronic pain conditions to reduce the dose of non-steroidals needed to help keep your pet pain-free. At number nine is that any pet who is on painkillers following surgery or injury, really make sure that you follow your vet's instructions fully to minimize pain and inflammation and allow a shorter course or a lower dose of medication to be used. Finally, at number 10 is that if your cat is fat, we should give them a dose appropriate to their ideal weight, not their actual weight. If we follow these recommendations, we can make sure our cats are really unlikely to experience any significant side effects, while at the same time they'll be as pain-free as possible. Don't be the owner who condemns their pet to suffer in silence when there is another way. Be sensible, yes. Don't use any drugs inappropriately, of course, but don't ignore pain. You owe that to your cat. Now, I expect anyone whose cats may have had side effects to comment. I know this video has not been sponsored by anyone. Please, though, let me know how painkillers have helped your cat to live a healthier, happier life. What have you noticed them doing? How have you noticed that their quality of life has improved? I would really love to hear from you. Also, if it's your first time here, consider subscribing to make sure that you don't miss out on future content and allow me to continue to help you and your cat. So until next time, I'm Dr. Alex from ourpetshealth.com, because they're family.